Yes, we're good to go.
Yes, sir. Yeah, a pleasant evening to everyone. I strongly believe one thing, that is, coming together is a beginning, keeping together is progress, working together is success. Yes, the Narayana success saga continues. So today, if you see the today's latest results like IIT, JEE, the Narayana rocked the show. The same way, our national builders of the future tackles today's biggest problem at EMAN 2020 today. So welcome you all for the sixth episode of EMAN. I sincerely convey my gratitude to our management, the soft skills department, and all the local heads supporting our students even in this pandemic situation by providing such a huge platform to showcase their skills. Yeah, today we have with us our head of the department, the soft skills, Mrs. Veda ma'am, and the AGMs of Prakasam Zone, Hariprasad sir, and the high school zonal coordinator, Sarath sir, and all the Telangana state dignitaries like principals, everyone, they are present in this live today. So now, I'll just hand it over to Ajay. Ajay, please respond.
Thank you, Sadhish. Thank you so much. Very good evening, one and all. This is Ajay, the regional soft skills trainer for Hyderabad hostel campuses. So I welcome you all for this program today on EMAN presentation, which is most awaited one. Well, let me give a chance to Sadhik sir. Can you please play the video?
Sure, Ajay. It's a small video bite by UN General Secretary Antonio Guterres.
Our world faces the biggest test since the Second World War. In these trying times, I welcome the holding of your model UN activity. Your commitment to international cooperation is essential for tackling the COVID-19 pandemic. We can only defeat the coronavirus if we do so globally. We must come together and support the most vulnerable. The United Nations is undertaking a wide-ranging response calling for a global ceasefire and working to control the pandemic, save lives, mitigate the socio-economic damage, fight stigma, and recover better. I draw great hope from seeing your generation mobilize to address the challenges of our time and to build a healthier, more equitable, and sustainable future for all. I wish you a successful Model UN.
So thank you. Now, I'd like to invite Hariprasad sir of Prakasam Zone, the AGM. Sir, please address this gathering, sir.
Hi, good evening to all, Veda ma'am, and all the RSTs and SSTs and students. Welcome to Narayana E-Model United Nations 2020 episode 6. We are congratulating our soft skills department as you have successfully completed 5 episodes, as we are giving a good knowledge to the students, which is improving, is useful to improve analytical skills, debating skills, and also teamwork, developing teamwork among the students or among the teachers, among the department. So I wish all the best for all the students, those who are participating in this episode 6, and especially very thankful to the management for the opportunity given to the department, soft skills department, and very thankful to the soft skills department as you are invited me to address this occasion. Thank you to Veda ma'am and other dignitaries, those who are in webinar. So thank you and all the best for all the students, those who are participating. Thank you one and all.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much. Ajay, sir, can you please invite the yes. Telangana state principals and...
Thank you. Thank you so much, Sadhik, sir. So we have a guest from Hyderabad. So let us call upon Hariprasad, sir, the principal for JHC campus, Hyderabad. Sir, please, sir, your words.
Good evening, Veda ma'am, all the delegates, principals, and the soft skills team. I welcome you all on this EMAN 2020, that is the Modern United Nations. As I was told that, and as we all know that this is a platform where our 9th standard students will be taking part as delegates of United Nations. These delegates select any country of their choice and then do their research work, addressing each and every part of that particular country. Our students here, that is Hyderabad students, they have selected Canada as their country, and they have done the research work for more than 2 months to find out the conditions of pre and post-COVID times. And I wish each and every one of them all the best. Let's listen from them and know the findings and learn much about Canada. All the best, children. And absolutely, there should not be any hesitation. There should not be any, what to say, tumbling. Absolutely, you know the best about that particular country. All the best, rock well, and let's see a wonderful program this evening. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir. And we also have Udayashree madam. Madam, Udayashree madam.
Yes, sir.
Your words, madam.
Good evening, all the dignitaries, Veda ma'am and other dignitaries and the delegates, those who are present here. This is Udayashree, principal of Narayanpura branch. Yeah, it is very proud and a happy moment for all of us to see our students to transform into this world as a global leaders, as a world leaders through such a powerful educational tool which we have made, that is, we are participating in this Model UN. I feel this era of the globalization and the learning about the world is more important than any other. Problems taking place half the way around the globe, but it is impacting on our lives. So this EMAN activity has brought the world into our students' homes with some valuable benefits, just like they have teaching them about the world and activating their imagination and creativity, building their confidence and their leadership skills, they are building themselves, and then many more. So this debut year of Narayana EMAN 2020 has been amazing till now. So today's presentation is an outcome of our teamwork of our students with great determination and coordination of these students who have shown a great, amazing change in their outlook. So I wish them a good luck and happy presenting, children, and through your eyes, show the all the people about the Canada, which the country you have selected. So all the best, delegates, very coolly present your presentation. Thank you all.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And we also have Geeta ma'am, our team leader, who is behind us from the beginning till today. So we also request Geeta ma'am, our team leader from the soft skills department, please, can you share your words?
Thank you, Ajay. Good evening, everybody, whoever is presented in this show. I really appreciate Hyderabad students. Hyderabad is always rocking in all the things. I saw the demo sessions. I saw the research work. I saw the first presentation where they have done it. And almost 260 members have been registered for this EMAN show. And out of it, this is the best show has been come out for the Facebook Live. I hope all others will do the best of here. Good luck, children. All the best. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Okay. Yes. Dakshani, ma'am, can we start it off? And now I'd like to request...
Yes, sir.
The students, now I'd like to request the students who is presenting the introduction of EMAN.
Yes, sir. Good evening to one and all. My name is P. Akshit from Narayanpura branch, 9th standard. Welcome to Narayana EMAN, United Nations 2020. Let us know what is MUN. Model United Nations is also known as Model UN or MUN. Model United Nations is an academic simulation of the United Nations, where students play the role of delegates from different countries and attempt to solve real-world issues with the policies and perspectives of their assigned country. It is usually is an extracurricular activity and allows students to develop deeper understanding of the current world issues. Participants in MUN conferences are known as delegates. Their pledging committees are assigned countries along with the topic. Delegates conduct research, formulate positions, and come up with policy proposals. At the end of a conference, they will vote on written policies called draft resolutions, with the goal of passing them with a majority vote. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals, also known as Global Goals, were adopted by all United Nations members states in 2015 as a universal call to action to end poverty, perfect the planet, protect the planet, and ensure that all people enjoy peace and prosperity by 2030. These development goals are blueprint to achieve better and more sustainable future for all. They address the global challenges we face related to poverty, inequality, climate change, environmental degradation, peace and justice. The 17 Sustainable Development Goals are all interconnected. That is, action in one area will affect outcomes in others. And in order to leave no one behind, it is important that we achieve them all by 2030. Today, we are going to present our research work on these 5 global goals of our assigned country, Canada, in North America: industry, innovation and infrastructure, climate change, responsible consumption and production, decent work and economic growth, and peace and justice, strong institutions. Our next delegate, Sarvesh, will introduce everyone about our country, Canada. Thank you.
Thank you, Akshit,
for giving some information about EMUN project. Dear audience, I am Sarvesh. Let me take you to Canada. Canada is located in North America beside Alaska at top of. So, next slide. Canada is located in North America beside Alaska and at top of USA. It extends from the Atlantic Ocean in the east to the Pacific Ocean in the west and the Arctic Ocean to the north. Canada is the second largest country in the world after Russia. It has the longest coastline in the world with a total length of 2,43,042 kilometers and occupies much of the continent of North America. It has the world's longest binational land border. It is geologically active, having many earthquakes and potentially active volcanoes. Weather of Canada is as diverse as its landscape. It covers 5 time zones. It is rarely the same season, in the same place, at the same time. The biggest part of Canada has a continental climate, all through average winter and summer. High temperatures across Canada vary according to the location. No doubt, our weather forecasters are the best in the world. Canada was ruled by British for 104 years, from 1763 to 1867. In 1867, on July 1st, Canada got independence. Its capital city is Ottawa, and Toronto is the largest city. The government system is federal parliamentary democracy under a constitutional monarchy. the head of the state is the Queen of the United Kingdom, and the head of the government is the Prime Minister of Canada. The present Prime Minister is Justin Trudeau. Canada is one of world's top trading nations. Alongside a dominant service sector, Canada also has vast oil reserves and is a major exporter of energy, food, and minerals. Both English and French enjoy official status, but common non-official first languages are Chinese, Japanese, Punjab, Tagalog, Arabic, German, and Italian. Traditions that are unique to Canada are Halloween, New Year's Levy, Calgary Stampede, new shoes on Budget Day, Thanksgiving, and French traditions. Thank you. The next delegate, Jishwant, will overtake. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarvesh, for introducing Canada for us. Good evening, audience. I am Jishwant, introducing you our topic, Industry, Innovation, and Infrastructure. These are the research questions we have researched on our topic. What are industries and infrastructure? What trend is seen in industries of Canada from 2000 to 2019? What impact did COVID-19 have on industries? And how can Canadian industries upgrade themselves? Infrastructure is a basic facilities and system required for a country or city community to function. It includes public transit networks, clean water systems, healthcare, electricity grids, sports and recreational facilities. Infrastructure is very important for economic growth of a country and well-being of its population. Canada is a highly developed market economy dominated by the service industry in 2019. The real GDP of Canada was around 1.64 trillion Canadian dollars at 2012 constant prices. During COVID-19 period, all types of industries and jobs in Canada were severely affected, and it also got a loss in including oil and gas as well as specialty items. To overcome this problem, one thought to strike a deal with online door delivery companies such as Amazon, Flipkart, and etc. These delivery companies help the manufacture projects by industry so that everyone can get benefits. From the next slide, the next delegate, Arjun, will continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Jishwant, for telling us about impact of COVID-19 on Canada's industries. Now I'm going to tell you what are markets and financial services, what trend is seen in financial services and markets of Canada between these 20 years, what impact will COVID-19 have on the financial services and markets of Canada, how can Canada increase its access to financial services and markets. You may ask, what are stock markets? Stock market is an aggregation of buyers and sellers of shares. Shares represent the value of the ownership of the company, and most of the investment is done by businessmen and stock brokers with the investment strength in their mind. Stocks may also be traded on other exchanges in other countries. Most of the small and big companies are registered on stock exchanges and raise funds through stock markets. Some large companies have stocks listed on more than one exchange in different countries so that they can attract foreign investors. Now I am going to tell you what are financial services. Financial services are which manage your money, banking, credit cards, customer finance companies, and some government-sponsored enterprises, etc. Financial services are present in every country, and international financial centers such as London, New York, Tokyo, etc. What trend was seen in COVID-19 situation? During these 20 years, across the industries of Canada, the trend was to develop their industries and make them more profitable, as shown in the graph below. What impact did COVID-19 have on different industries? Banking. Banks may suffer bad loans, and also new loans will take a lot of time to recover. Automobiles. Because of job loss, people will not spend their money on automobiles. Instead of buying new cars, people will prefer pre-owned. Real estate will incur losses due to low sales, and developers may have to bear extra cost to finish the existing projects. Tourism. This sector will take a lot of time to recover, and people will avoid traveling until normalcy returns. Hotels. Many people will also not like to stay or eat in hotels. Telecom and pharma. This sector had the least effect. Instead of having a loss, this sector had huge profits. How can Canada increase its access to financial services and markets? Corona is a pandemic. It represents a big health threat, and it has a major impact on global economy. Some sectors like travel, hospitality, IT, automobiles, real estates are in huge losses, resulting in loss of their share value as well. So, banks will give everyone affordable credits and enough time to pay their credits back. Companies will not have any money to pay their employees, so they will depend on credits. And also, jobless people will depend on credits to buy their household needs. For this reason, Canada is acting in several ways to stabilize their economy and financial system. Our literature review. We researched on our topic and collected data from internet and e-newspapers. We observed that many countries have never seen or have been affected by like this virus till now. And also, no one knows the cure to this pandemic. We conclude that no one knows when will this crisis end or when will we find a cure. So we need to be cautious and be prepared to face this virus. Take precautions to save ourselves from corona. We recommend some precautions like cover your nose and mouth while coughing or sneezing with your hands. Wash or sanitize your hands before going out and after coming home. While going out, wear a mask. Maintain at least 3 feet distance between you and the other. Avoid crowded places and use alcohol-based sanitizers. A functioning and resilient infrastructure is the foundation of every successful community. To meet the future challenges, we must upgrade our industries. For this, we need to promote innovations, sustainable technologies, and ensure equal and universal access to information and financial markets. This will bring prosperity, create jobs, and make sure we build a stable and prosperous societies across the globe. Solution to this is we need to invest, innovate, and build resilient infrastructure. Thank you. From next, the next delegate, Saikruti, will be continuing.
Thank you, Arjun. It was a lovely presentation. Good evening, audience. I am Saikruti presenting you the topic climate change. What is climate change? The environmental threat to our world is greater than any time in human history. Just look around. We already seeing the impacts of climate change across the world. Climate change is a natural phenomenon and has been occurring since the Earth came into being. Climate change is a natural phenomenon and has been occurring since the Earth came into being. This includes temperature, wind patterns, and precipitation. This change is referred to in a global sense and concerns the Earth as a whole. Since Industrial Revolution, the climate has increasingly been affected by human activities leading to global warming. and climate change. You can see the images, the temperature in the last 50 years, and the whole earth has been getting warmer. Coming to Canada, its annual average temperature over land has been warmer by 1.7 degrees Celsius since 1948. The rate of warming is even higher in Canada's north and in prairies and northern British Columbia. It is the average weather of a given area or region. The topic climate change is very large, and my team has researched on how to build knowledge and capacity to meet climate change. And our research questions are, what climate change is seen in Canada? How was Canada's climate change in past 20 years since 2000 to 2019? What should Canada government do to build knowledge and capacity to meet climate change? And what impact does COVID-19 have on Canada? Before COVID, Canadians have been experiencing the cost of climate-related extreme firsthand, from devastating wildfires and flooding to heat waves and droughts. As the planet warms, extreme weather events will become increasingly common. The knowledge provided by our scientists has helped us to understand that climate change is really a real and is driven by human activities. The image shows how the climate of Canada is and the different health risks from Canada in climate change. And COVID-19 is taking a toll on almost every aspect of lives of Canadians. The global spread of the virus has brought illness, suffering, and anxiety. These measures will be helpful to combat climate change. We have to strengthen resilience and adaptive capacity to climate-related hazards and natural disasters. We need to integrate climate change measures into national policies, strategies, and planning. We have to implement the NCCC commitment. We have to promote mechanisms for raising capacity for effective climate change-related planning and management. We have to promote afforestation and reforestation globally. We have to conserve the ecosystem. We have to take urgent action to end poaching and trafficking of protected species. We have to integrate ecosystem biodiversity value into national local planning. We have to mobilize financial resources from all sources to conserve sustainable use of biodiversity and ecosystem, enhance global effort to combat poaching and trafficking of protected species. Coming to our literature review, we researched our topic and collected data from different sources like YouTube, Wikipedia, Global Goals website, etc. We observed that many changes have taken place in Canada in past 19 years. And according to our findings and observations, we conclude that Canada's climate is a bit harsh, but okay. It needs to take some preventive measures like export clean technologies globally, adopt clean indigenous energy solutions to access information on cleaning technology. We conclude the climate is changing. The climate is always changing naturally, but in last 200 years, human activities have an added influence. Even with all the measures taken, it will take decades to reverse global warming. So we must be prepared to manage extreme weather and natural disasters. All nations must work together to help and mitigate, adapt the climate change and its impacts for the benefits of people everywhere. Here are some solutions that we recommend to you. Thank you for your kind attention. I welcome the next delegate, Manthan, to continue. Thank you.
Manthan, you there?
Manthan, please unmute yourself, Manthan.
Manthan, unmute.
Thank you, Kriti, for letting us know about the climate of Canada. Good evening, audience. I am Manthan, presenting you the topic, Responsible Consumption and Productions. our planet has provided us with an abundance of natural resources, but we have not utilized them responsibly and currently consume far beyond whatever planet can provide. We must learn how to use and produce in sustainable ways that will reverse the harm that we have inflicted on the planet. We must make sure the production process from the manufacturer to consumer does no harm nature nor humanity generates as little as waste possible. We have to protect water, air, soil. We must prevent food wastage. The focus of our research work. What is the management of chemicals and waste? How does Canada can manage the responsible the industrial chemicals and waste? What impact COVID-19 has on responsible management of chemicals and waste in Canada? At the bar graph, Canada general government spending of each environmental protection category from 2008 to 2016, those are water management, waste management, pollution abatement, environmental protection, waste water management, protection of biodiversity and landscape, total environmental protection. And these are the ways where energy have been used. The natural resources available in Canada. The natural resources include natural gas, crude oil, crude bitumen is also known as oil sand. Coal mineral resources include nickel, gold, silver, copper zinc, lead zinc, iron, molybdenum, uranium, potash, and diamonds. The pie chart shows the different natural resources available in Canada. Those are 3.3% is stone, sand, gravel, and crushed stone. 5.2% is fuel oil, and 7.5% is wheat. 10.8% is crude petroleum, and 15.8% is iron ores and concentrates. 17.6% is coal, and the biggest one, 39.7%, is other commodities. In 2000, the image shows Canadians' main exports destinations, USA, UK, and China. In 2015, Canada exported 76% to USA, 6% to UK, and 4% to China, and earned $220 billion Canadian dollars. Responsible management of chemicals and waste. Chemicals are important for the manufacture of many products and protection of human health. They contribute the GDP and employment. Bad management practices of chemicals and their hazardous waste poses a significant risk to the environment and human health. In Canada, the management of hazardous waste and recycled materials is divided into a shared responsibility between federal government and provincial government. The impact of COVID-19 on efficient use of natural resources in Canada. The combined effect of COVID-19 and the global oil supply glut have reduced the price of Western Canadian Select to the history of lows. That has created an unprecedented level of uncertainty in the Canadian oil and the gas industry. Every 2 years, the Statistics Canada releases the national and provincial waste statistics. In 2016, approximately 25 million tons of non-hazardous waste has sent to the disposal across the country, broken down by the source. Non-residential sector generated 14.7 million tons, 59%, and residential sector generated 10.2 million tons, 41% of waste disposed in 2016. Data analyzing. Natural resources are essential of our quality of life. They help build, fuel, and feed the world. While natural resources production is needed to support growing global prosperity, it is also clear that there are implications for the environment. Since 20 years, the natural resources of Canada have been decreased 50% of its original. Conclusion. The COVID-19 pandemic has expose the fragility of the supply chain and the need for an urgent and systemic transformation of the way and we produce and consume. We need to acknowledge the responsibility of the private and public sectors to address unsustainable consumption needs, to adopt tools to help ensure that there are healthier, more sustainable, and the safer choice is the easier choice for the citizens. As the market will not deliver sustainable outcomes, automatically the strategy on the sustainable consumption is necessary now more than ever to create a regulatory framework that is conducive to sustainable post-crisis initiatives. Recommendations. These recommendations can create an action for responsible consumption and production. We have to implement the 10-year sustainable consumption and production framework. We have to manage and use the natural resources sustainably. We have to encourage companies to adopt sustainable practices and sustainable reporting. We have to promote sustainable public procurement practices. We have to remove market disasters that encourage wasteful consumption. We have to support developing countries' scientific and technological capacity for sustainable consumption and production. We have to decrease global per capita food waste to half. We have to develop and implement tools to monitor sustainable tourism. We have to reduce waste generation. We have to promote universal understanding sustainable of lifestyle. Thank you for your kind attention. I welcome the next delegate, Arun and Satyavart, to continue. Thank you.
Thank you, Manthan, for presenting your topic, Responsible Consumption and Production. Good evening, one and all. I'm Satyavart from GHC branch. Actually, we are a team of 5 members, but now me and my friend Arun will present our topic, Decent Work and Economic Growth. Kerala. Decent work and economic growth, why it matters. Economic growth to each other. Opportunities of work delivers fair income, security in the workplace, and social protection for families. Here, decent work provides job opportunities for all the citizens. By that, employment rate increases. If employment rate increases, the economic growth also increases. How many jobs are unemployed? According to International Labour Organization, ILO, more than 2.4 billion people are unemployed as of 2015. How many jobs are needed? 470 million jobs are needed globally for the new entrants to the labour market. 30 million. Number of jobs required every year for the new entrants to the labour market. Aims of decent work. Promoting jobs. We should promote the job opportunities, create new jobs so that it supports the employment and increases the economy. Guaranteeing rights at work. All the workers need to have a representation. To ensure that they work with all their interests, we should create a few laws and rights to the workers so they can work satisfactorily. Extending social protection. We should provide a safe and secure work conditions for the people. Promoting social dialogue. Strong and independent workers can increase the productivity, so we should try to avoid disputes in the workplace and create a friendly environment between the workers.
Let us know about what is decent work and economic growth. The decent work includes the fundamental rights and in terms of conditions of work safety and remuneration. The aim of the resultation is to promote the inclusive and sustainable economic growth and employment and decent work for all. It also includes the well-paid jobs for all the people in Canada, irrespective of age, gender, family status, and social economic background.
Yes, ma'am, continue.
These are the problems we identified during. economic growth of Canada? What are the impacts of COVID-19 on employment? What are the steps to overcome the present situation? We have tried to answer all these questions. These are the problems we identified during our research process, problem of unemployment and problem of poverty. We have gone through these research questions. What is sustainable economic growth? What are the factors that help in increasing economic growth of Canada? What are the impacts of COVID-19 on employment? What are the steps to overcome the present situation? We have tried to answer all these questions.
So, by coming to our research process, most of the populations below the breadline, which is influenced by the poverty as well. As a factor that influences the proper work opportunities leads to uneven distribution of economic growth. So coming to the poverty, it is mainly due to the lack of proper work opportunities leads to uneven economic growth. To ensure the sustainable economic growth, it is essential for creating the job opportunities for all the people in Canada. In Canada, over 2 million of people work in temporary jobs and raised up to minimum wage of $15. So by having the proper work opportunities, they can lead a secure life.
Coming to the graphs, the first graph shows about Canada's unemployment rate in March 2020. Unemployment rate increased from 6% to 7.8%. The participation rate decreased from 65.8% to 63.5%. And the economy lost 1,011,000 net jobs in March. The second graph shows about Canada's unemployment rate 1976 to 2020. In 1976, Canada's unemployment rate was 7%, and at the 90s recession, it increased to 12%, and now due to COVID-19 pandemic, the unemployment rate is continuously increasing. The third was about statistics. The fourth graph shows unemployment rate in Canada.
So we know that the impact of corona in each country is more. So let us know about the impact of corona in Canada. It is forecasted that the economy will enter into the recession in 2020, that it indicates the negative growth. By shutdowning the services to control the spread of COVID-19 has had severe economic consequences in Canada. Due to this, there are severe impacts. Loss of 2 million jobs and unemployment rate was doubled and it is reached up to 14%.
We have found the following things through our research process. Sustainable economic growth helps in increasing economic rate. Canada has abundant natural resources which can be properly utilized. COVID-19 crisis did have a reasonable impact on Canada's economic growth. Canada should welcome more immigrants after COVID-19. Before COVID-19, global economic growth was slowing down. COVID-19 implications, the world faces the worst economic recessions. During COVID-19 pandemic, 1.6 billion workers lost their livelihood. Tourism has been facing unprecedented challenges due to COVID-19. COVID-19 could cause 400 million job losses in second quarter of 2020. According to CIPC, people situation back in 2021 will say that they need to get a better handle on their money matters. 63% are cutting back on unnecessary spending. 46% say that the pandemic has impacted the finances negatively.
Canada will survive the COVID-19 crisis with a few problems that will be resolved by the following recommendations. Promoting the policies which can create a new jobs and support the organizations, support the growth and organizations. By developing the strategies which provides the good employment opportunities for youth. Full employment and decent pay with equal pay. Promoting beneficial and sustainable tourism. Using of limited resources efficiently by improving the production by reducing the cost of production, universal access to banking and insurance and financial services, and promoting youth employment and education and training. Recovery from COVID-19 pandemic will require the collaborations across organizations and markets. Government of Canada will take the decisions that affected sectors after COVID-19. By our research process, we have find some solutions to diversifications, upgrading the technologies and innovating the new methods which we can achieve the higher levels, encourage the formalizations which helps the organizations to achieve its goals, and and encourage the growth of micro, small, and medium-sized enterprises. By protecting the labor rights, we can ensure the workers will work satisfactorily. By promoting a safe and secure working environments for all the workers, including the migrant workers, especially women migrants, we can increase the productivity.
According to my observation, Canada is a successful country with its abundant natural resources. I feel that it is the best country educational-wise. Canada is a tough country, positively handling the impact of COVID-19 and soon will recover from the situation. From here on, Angela will carry forward.
Thank you, Sajwal. What a lovely presentation. Good evening, everyone. My name is Sanjana. Today, I'm going to talk about Peace, Justice, Strong Institution in Canada. What is peace, justice, and strong institution? Peace describes a relationship between any people categorized by respect and goodwill. Calmness, serenity, silence are the synonyms for peace. Strong institution and laws are essentially for protecting civil rights, people's rights, and they should ensure that everyone can live free of discrimination, violence, and exploitation. Why peace and justice important? Peace and justice promote a non-violent solutions to everyday problems and leads to a civil society. Peace with justice helps in security of children, primary health care, and promotes an end to a violence of cruelty. Why are strong institutions important? Strong institutions are considered to be an essential foundation for sustainable development goals. The belief is that these reforms lead to better institutions that are able to provide rule of law and support economic growth and reduce poverty through basic services. The problems that I identify are the most frequently identified problems by the government all over the world: violence, bribery, and child abuse. Many have focused on these questions while researching. One, how to use technology in promotion of peace? What are tools? What are the innovative efforts for peace and justice? In 2017, 68.5 million people were displaced by violence and conflicts. Few countries have 50% and more cases, and few more have 30% and more. There are 50% of women in Canada, but only 27% of women are member of parliament, MPs. However, Canada was ranked as in the least corrupt nation. However, in recent year, corruption have been an increasing concern, and it is a large problem in governmental and non-governmental organizations. Violence against children affects more than 1 billion children around the world. 1 in 3 internet users are children. 8 million of them are becoming a victim of an online violence by social media. 50% of the children all over the world are experiencing the violence every year. COVID-19 is a pandemic in Canada and also an ongoing worldwide pandemic. The virus confirmed that has reached Canada on January 27, 2020 after an individual who had returned to Toronto from China. As of September 11, 2020, there have been over 1,34,924 confirmed cases and 1,18,990 recoveries and 9,163 deaths in Canada. Lockdown may affect the rights of women, which increases the risk of gender-based violence. There may be a chance of breaking fundamental rights. There can be an injustice for women or a discrimination against women. Because every child is at home, there is a chance of increase in child abuse and child labor system. Many companies are firing employees due to loss or due to the situation. So there may be an increase in crime rate due to unemployment. If you see in this slide, you can say that before COVID, every 100 civilians are killed in armed conflicts. After COVID, its implications further threaten to be global peace and security. If you see, global homicide rate has declined slowly. 127 countries have adopted the right to inform law or freedom of information law. If you see the graph, next slide, sir. If you see the graph, green line refers to violent crimes like harassment, homicides, abuses, and etc. Blue line refers to property crimes like burglary, theft, etc. Red line refers to other crime. And if you see, Canada decreased the rate of homicides, but again, it started increasing its rate from 2018. How to maintain peace and justice? Reduce violence everywhere. Significantly reduce all form of violence and related to death rate everywhere. I have divided into two main types, which are frequently identified all over the world: gun violence and gender-based violence. Gun violence is a growing concern for Canadians, especially in Toronto, the biggest city of Canada. Toronto had the most overall homicides of the year 2018 as well as 2019. Toronto declared as a city of guns in 2005. Gender-based violence, any act that results in a physical or psychological harm to men or women is known as gender-based violence. Women in Canada live at a greater risk of harassment and abuses. In 2017, the Government of Canada launched a Canada strategy to prevent and address gender-based violence. Sustainably reduce corruption and bribery. An act of giving or taking an illegal payment to someone to act in one's favor is known as bribery. It is considered to be a white-collar crime. What is white-collar crime? A crime that is technically involved in a stealing or giving or taking money from a company, and that is done by a person who has an important position in the company. Example of bribery: in a candidate of election or some party offers in a bottle of liquor in exchange of votes. Consequences of bribery. Potential penalties include fine and imprisonment for up to 14 years. Protect children from abuse, exploitation, trafficking in all form of violence. Child abuse is a serious health issue that has an innovative of significant social and criminal justice. It also results in a serious physical or emotional harm, exploitation, or death of the child. Sometimes youth or child may experience this in the care of a person they trust or they depend on, like relatives, caretaker, or guardian. One by three victims of police reported cases were harmed by their families. My recommendations to resolve the problems of peace, justice, strong institutions are: promote and enforce non-discriminatory laws and policies. Ensure responsive, inclusive, and representative decision making. Promote the rule of law, and ensure equal access to justice. Few suggestions to maintain peace and justice are: require background checks for all gun sales so we don't sell guns to criminals or someone else. Ban assaults to weapons and high capacity of ammunition magazines. Establish anti-corruption policies to reduce bribery. Provide resources to children so they can report abuses as soon as possible. Justice system is flexible and good. The biggest problem facing the world can only be solved through the international cooperation. The internet provides an efficient, fast, trackable, confidential, organized, time and space independent mean of communication. We must also take an advantage of technological innovations to prevent, mitigate, and resolve conflicts. According to my findings, I conclude that peaceful and inclusive society for sustainable development provide access to justice for all and build an effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions at all levels. Nowadays, women abuse, child abuse, and bribery have begun to increase. So we should try to resolve them and be the responsible citizen of our country. Thank you. Our next delegate, Lokesh, will continue.
Thank you, Sanjana. It's a lovely presentation. And we wish peace and justice around the world. Good evening to one and all. I'm Lokesh from Narayanaguda branch. Dear audience, for our research work on Canada, we collected data from existing data available on the net, interpersonal, interpretive, and presentational modes of communication were used by us. And references used are Google, Wikipedia, Google course website, and YouTube, etc. May I have the next? For our research work, we were guided and supported by the committee members consisting of principals, soft skills trainers, faculty members. Coming to the learnings of the project, from this live project, we worked as a team with coordination and collaboration. We learned critical thinking, analytical skills, and observational skills. And we have improved presentational and communication skills. Now it's time to thank everyone. First and foremost, we are grateful to Almighty for his blessings and giving us the strength to successfully complete our project. Secondly, we thank our parents for their support and encouragement. We feel happy to be a part of Narayan Group, which encourages such co-curricular activities, even as made us explore the world. We express our special thanks of gratitude to our AGMs, branch principals, teachers, and soft skills team who guided us during this project and saw that we complete it on our own. Last but not least, special thanks to the soft skills department. This amazing project gave us memorable experience of our lifetime. Thank you.
Thank you very much, the delegates of Canada, for your wonderful presentations. So before moving to the Indian delegate presentation, I would like to share you the success saga of Narayana with a small video. Just have a look.
So much more to learn, we'll be the finest minds you've ever seen. Determination pays, there is no other way. We don't stop until we rise. We are Narayana, teach high Narayana, march on Narayana.
Yeah, this is the success saga. The background song which you heard, it's the Narayana's official song. So once again, I'll just read out the success saga of IIT and JEE result. So the Narayana institutions have produced All India Open Category, first rank, sixth rank, and eighth rank in top 10. And we are extremely proud to say that we have got All India first rank in girls category. So that's the biggest achievement. So now we'll move on to the Indian delegates. The Indian delegates, are you guys ready? Yes, let me share you the screen for you. Yes, Hasit, please continue. Hasit, the delegate of India. Okay,
can I start, sir?
Yeah, please.
Okay. Hi, a very warm evening and an honorable welcome to everyone who gathered here from our delegates of India. And also, this is the first EMUN 2021st edition. And we are also very honorable. And we are here to make you to know about the consequences which were faced by India in this global pandemic, COVID-19, in several consequences and fields. And by the way, in the brief, Akshaya and Jahnavi are taking lead of reduced inequalities, insurgency, peace, justice, and strong institutions. And myself, Sri Hasid, and I'm going to make you know about sustainable cities and communities. Before we start, let us know about India. India is the cradle of human race, the birthplace of human species, the mother of history, the grandmother of legend, the great-grandmother of tradition. Our most valuable and most instructive materials of a man are treasured up in India only. As a rising economic powerhouse and a nuclear armed state, India emerged as an important regional power, home to the world's most ancient surviving civilization, and also with a huge population of 1.3 billion people. This is India, but now, as like every other country, India is too facing the consequences which were made by the pandemic COVID-19. And it also lost some of its pillars. And one of the main pillars, which is also a reason of development, is sustainable cities and communities. But how sustainable cities and communities works and helps? Making cities sustainable means creating career and business opportunities, safe and affordable housing, and building resilient societies and economies. It involves investment in green public spaces and improving urban planning and management in participatory and inclusive ways. And the main theme of sustainable cities and communities is to make human settlements inclusive, safe, resilient, and sustainable. As before COVID-19, there's a change of development and stabilizing the city. But after COVID-19, we can see a change. So let's also take some brief analysis before and after COVID-19. Before COVID-19, in a part of development, more than half of humanity, 4.2 billion people, lives in cities. And by 2030, it is estimated that the 6 out of 10 people will be city dwellers. By 2030, the world is projected to have 43 megacities with more than 10 million inhabitants each, most of them in developing regions. However, some of the fastest growing urban agglomerations are cities with fewer than 1 million inhabitants each, many of them located in Asia and Africa, while 1 of 8 people lives in 33 megacities worldwide. Close to half of the world's urban dwellers reside in much smaller settlements with fewer than 5 lakh inhabitants. The world cities occupy just 3% of the planet's land, but an account of 60 to 80% of all day energy consumption and 75% of the planet's carbon emissions. Our rapidly growing urban world is experiencing congestion, a lack of basic services, and a shortage of adequate housing and declining infrastructure. More than 30% of the world's urban population lives in slums. And in sub-Saharan Africa, over half to all city dwellers are slum dwellers. But the situation after COVID-19 is quite different. The impacts of the global COVID-19 pandemic are still being understood, but it does seem clear that the crisis will make a mark on cities physically and socially, and that will echo for generations. It's too much early to know the full extent of the economic, social, and psychological dislocation of the crisis will cause. But it's clear that the mayors and the city officials are in the front line, with implications both broad and deep for local government. At the same time, while the top priority is to stop the virus and stabilize economies and communities, even UN Secretary General has pointed that the 2030 agenda as a natural organizing principle once the world can shift its focus to recovery. And this also, I think, impacts much being affected on the cities, on sustainable cities. So let's take some impact analysis of COVID-19 in different fields on a city. In industrials, we see there's a negative impact due to COVID-19 outbreak is expected to reduce to a low growth rate compared to the global GDP growth. And also there's a negative impact on markets in several aspects. So I think the next slide. Next slide. So I think you all agree there's an important role of sustainable cities and communities in a part of development. If you are not, and I will explain once more about some few important lines. Cities are engines for sustainable development. These were ideas, commerce, culture, science, and productivity thrive. Urban spaces offer opportunities for people to prosper economically and socially. But this is only possible in prosperous cities that can accommodate people in decent jobs, and where land only possible in prosperous. Resources are not overheld by growth. Unplanned urban sprawl, as cities build beyond their formal boundaries, can be detrimental to national developmental planning and to global goals for sustainable development. Our areas are also emitters of greenhouse gases and contribute to climate change. If you agree, as a result, we see India is urbanizing rapidly. Between 2001 and 2011, the country urban population has increased by 91 million. India is projected to add 460 million urban dwellers between 2080 and 2050. By 2030, India is expected to have home to 7 megacities with population about 10 million. 68% of the country's total population lives in rural areas, while 17% of the country's urban population lives in slums. This is India's goals for future megacities. But I think since we are only discussing about what should we increase from quite a long time, but let's also take a look what should we decrease in amount of percentage or number. The sustainable name development and goals. By 2030, India will have 7 megacities with populations over 10 million people. And 31% lives in urban areas, which is increased. And 17% of urban population lives in slums, which used to be decreased. And 13% of urban households don't have sanitary toilets, which is decreased, and 62 tons per annum waste generated in cities, which is also increased. Over 1.2 million population related deaths in 2017, which is described. And as a conclusion, I would like to conclude you. The smart cities concept has gained a lot of attention lately, and it will be most likely to continue to do so in the future. Cities are publishing smart plans, related conferences are trending, and more books are being written on the subject. Smart technologies can provide solutions for cities by helping them save money, reduce carbon emissions, and manage traffic flows. But the complexity of the agenda is hindering its process. I think you have acknowledgement about sustainable cities and communities now. So let's, and from here, our next delegate will take the lead. Thank you. Over to Akshaya and Zahnavi.
Thank you, Hasit. Respected dignitaries, trainers, dear friends, good evening all. I'm Banu Akshaya.
I'm Jahnavi. We are from Ongole ONCS. We heartily welcome you all on the behalf of Women Presentation.
First of all, we would like to thank Jansi Ma'am, Sadiq Sir, and all teachers for giving this opportunity. And thanks to our parents and siblings for helping in this presentation.
The reason behind why we've chosen this topic is only in India, we have this type of inequality and division among the people. All across the world, there is only inequality called blacks and whites. But in India, we have many types of inequalities. You are going to see all of them in our presentation.
Today, I'm going to share my views about one of the major threats of India, that is inequality. What is inequality? Inequality is concerned with disparities in the distribution of certain things, which can be income, health, or any other material. To share this in my normal words, when a thing is not distributed equally among the people, whether it is money, food, or whatever it may be, we can call it as inequality. Situation of India. We are hearing from many years that India is one of the fastest developing countries. But at the same time, it is one of the most unequal countries. But we want to see India as a developed country. To make it possible, we have to abolish inequality. We can see these details in the next slide. What is the need to abolish inequality? Health. Life expectancy is shorter and mortality rates are higher. This applies to both poor and rich in these societies. Rates of infant mortality, obesity, illness are 2 to 4 times higher. Social relationships. Indicators of women's status and equality also tend to be worse. More unequal societies have more property, crime, and violence. Human capital development. More young people drop out of education and employment and training. More teenage girls become mothers. More equal countries tend to have higher rates of innovation. Economic progress and stability. In rich and poor countries, inequality is strongly correlated with shorter spells of economic expansion and less growth over time. We can see various types of inequalities, and here they are. Types of inequalities. First, let us see with income inequality. Income inequality is an extreme disparity of income distributions with high concentration of income, usually in hands of a small percentage of a population. Educational inequality. Educational inequality is unequal distribution of academic resources, school funding, experienced teachers, books, etc. Caste or religion inequality. Caste inequality is a hereditary stratification system. This caste determines one's lifestyle, prestige, and occupational choices. Gender inequality. Gender inequality refers to unequal treatment of individuals based on their gender. It arises from differences in brain structure and hormonal differences. Reasons of inequality. Political stability, education and skills, working culture, natural resources, savings and investment are the few reasons of inequality. Over to Jahnavi.
Thank you, Banu. My friend Banu introduced us types of inequalities. Now, we are going to talk about the major problem facing by us from the generations of our forefathers. Yes, it's the caste inequality. The caste system is high in the northern part of Asia. In India, this caste system was started by Aryans of northern Asia. They set a group of people and subdivided them into small groups and set a particular kind of work for them. Here, the caste inequality started in India. At present, in India, there were 3,000 castes and 25,000 subcastes based on their type of occupation. To treat all these people equally, Dr. B.R. Ambedkar written our Indian Constitution. Our Indian Constitution is the longest constitution in the world, with 444 articles in 22 parts, 12 schedules, and 124 amendments, with 1,46,385 words in English version. Now let us know what is caste inequality. Caste inequality is a hereditary stratification system. In Hindu tradition, a person is born into a caste determines one's lifestyle, prestige, and occupational choices, such as Brahmins, who are the teachers of Vedas, weavers who work on their own handlooms. The five castes of Hindus are elite class, warrior class, merchant class, and servant class, and the untouchables. According to Manudharma Sastra, Manu said there were only four main castes in Hindu tradition. They are Brahmins, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, and Sudras, and the other outcast belongs to Dalits. Manu hadn't noticed or defined about this untouchability, but we faced it. Future estimations of caste inequality. For some reasons, unfortunately, the caste system led to discrimination among the people. It created a lot of unnecessary fights among the people in the society. High tendency of lot of inhuman activities. The more is the division, the harder it becomes to control the internal wars among the castes. Here are some words said by Dr. B.R. Ambedkar about this caste system. Caste has killed the public spirit. caste has destroyed the sense of public charity. Caste made public opinion impossible. Virtue has become caste-ridden and morality has become caste-bound. Suggestions to end this caste system. First of all, we have to remove the caste-based reservations and start giving them based upon the poverty of the person. And after, we have to start single matrimony sites for Hindus so that there will be perfect matches. IT bride for IT bridegroom and etc. In forms and applications such as admission forms in schools and colleges, don't ask class such as BC, OC, SI and etc. Just ask the occupation of father and mother so that the scholarship will be based on the father's and mother's income. Advantages in ending this caste system. Ends the dowry system, which became a big burden for bride's family. Ends the domestic violence on women. Builds a great unity among the Indians. Decreases the crime rate in the society. Effects of caste inequality before COVID-19. The people of elite class, warrior class, and merchant class are financially strong, and majority of them have jobs and well-settled families. They have better conditions to live their life. But people of servant class don't have all these facilities. Effects of caste inequality after COVID-19. As if the higher classes have minimum financial support, they don't have much problem to lead their life. They may lead their life normally. But the problem is only with the lower caste people. They face many difficulties in their life. Nothing will be normal as before in their lives. Over to Banu.
Thank you, Jahnavi. How to reduce inequality? Here, I'm giving you one simple method which is going to work efficiently. That is redistribution. As I told you already, most of the wealth was with some people only. India's richest hold more than 4 times the wealth of country. We have to extract money from them and we have to distribute it to the poor. I mean, that's why government is imposing taxes on rich people and it is distributing that wealth to the poor people through some government schemes. Inequality after COVID-19 pandemic. COVID-19 is not showing any inequality. In its view, everyone is at same level of risk. Male and female, rich and poor, politicians and celebrities are seeming to be equally at risk. However, virus may not showing any inequality, but the inequality was not completely abolished. COVID-19 has been a bad news for billionaires. According to Bloomberg report, top 500 richest people of world lost $444 billion at stock markets. On other hand, low-wage workers, daily laborers faced vulnerable conditions. Almost all of the daily laborers lost their jobs. Women are 70% of world health workers and they are working on the front line, putting themselves on higher risk. Many men got work from home opportunities. In such situation, domestic violence is the result of lockdown. I urge all governments to put women's safety first. No pandemic can change the world. Only humans can change this. Changing the way of thinking can make this possible. It is a chance to realize nothing is permanent and we are all equal. All these my words I have represented pictorially in this slide. India is not only the country which is facing inequality. Many other countries also facing the same problem. Here China is at first place and India is at second place. But whatever, being on second place is also dangerous. The problem may be population or whatever it is, we have to work on it and we have to solve it. Here is a pie chart which describes gender inequality. First one is about overall workforce, which is men 53% and women 47%, which is approximately equal. But we can see huge difference in low-wage workforce. Men 24% and women 76%. Here, men are not interested to work for low wages because they have more employment opportunities. But in case of women, they don't have many opportunities. So they have to settle for low wages. There are few persons who broke the barriers of inequality. Kalpana Chawla, she is the first lady flew to the space and she is an American astronaut. APJ Abdul Kalam is very motivated person, hardworking, and he was born in poor family. Kiran Bedi. Kiran Bedi is first lady IPS officer and she made all women proud. Sania Mirza. She is famous tennis player. She won 6 grand titles in her career. Baba Saheb Ambedkar. He born in the least category even though he broke the barrier of inequality.
By this presentation, we understood the situation of our Indian society and how it was affected by all these inequalities. To break the barriers of inequalities, unity among the people is needed. It's just like a sports team. Each and every player is important in a team. Same like that, each and every category is important in a society. Thank you.
I would like Shravanti to continue peace, justice, and strong institutions.
Thank you, Banu and Jahnavi. And a warm evening to respected dignitaries, teachers, and all my dear friends. I'm Lakshmi Shravanti from Ongole ENCS. Now I'm here to share the topic and the views about peace, justice, and strong institutions. How to prevent the wars? Do the wars, best way to solve the problems? Let's know. Stop fighting and start shaking. Maintaining friendly relations with neighbors for peace is a good solution for peace and maintain peace also. Justice. Why? Many cases pending till now in India. A best solution is to increase district and session courts for every district. And why are strong institutions are important? Yeah, the belief that strong institutions are able to provide rule of law, abolish poverty, and reduce crime rate. So strong institutions are very important. Coming to peace, can you explain peace in simple words? Yeah, peace is nothing but the avoiding war and violence, especially when people live and work together happily without disagreements. In simple words, freedom from disturbance is called peace. Peace. Peace is the concept of social friendship and the absence of violence. Peace is not only the absence of violence, but the presence of justice. Peace needs unity and commitment, not to a particular person, but to the nation as a whole. Without peace in a nation, it is impossible to achieve political strength and economical stability. Youth plays an important role in bringing up the peace. There are many ways to achieve peace, but it starts from oneself. In bringing up the peace, youth plays an important role. So government should provide basic facilities to the youth. Students must have a subject related to peace in their schools, not a lesson. Post-graduation courses must be related to peace more. Peace needs unity and commitment. Justice. Justice is like truth in action. Justice is the morally fair and right state for everything. Justice is a concept on ethics and law. There are three types of justice. First one, distributive. Second one, procedural. Third one, interactional. Justice is very important aspect because it makes life possible in our complex and civilized society. Justice is delayed, justice is denied. Why I'm saying this, let us see now. There are 59,687 cases pending in Supreme Court and 44.75 lakh cases in various high courts. There are 29.7 million civil and criminal cases. There are 61,970 divorce cases in India. If the cases get justice quickly, it will be very beneficial to the people. Justice. Justice is like a train that is nearly always late. Strong institutions. What is strong institutions? Strong institutions. Developing effective and accountable institutions is very necessary for a developing country like India. Institutions act as the pillars for economic growth also. Strong institutions are considered to be the essential foundation. Strong institutions led to provide rule of law, economic growth, and reduce poverty. These institutions encourage trust by providing resources properly allocated and ensures that poor are protected. By the strong institution, they can do many like reduce poverty. We can see here the graph representation of peace, justice, and strong institutions. Finally, I can conclude my topic by saying that peace, justice, and strong institutions are interrelated. Thank you.
Thank you very much, the delegates of India. We have end the presentation. Now over to Veda ma'am.
Thank you so much, Sadiq.
Yeah.
You know, as the students were presenting it, it reminds me of one particular quote which says that, you know, true leaders do not create followers, they create leaders. True. They create more leaders. This is what precisely Narayana Group of Institutions is doing today. They are the pioneers, they are the leaders in the education industry. We have witnessed it and we are going to witness it even in the future. Saying so, they're also training their students to become the future leaders, and we could witness it very well today with Iman's sixth episode. Right? With this, I congratulate all the students taking a path of a leadership and I wish you all the very best. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. In this regard, I sincerely convey my heartfelt gratitude to all the principals, the teachers, the academic deans and vice principals, and the parents, especially because they supported a lot to our students, and the siblings, you know, their brothers and their sisters. They helped them there for the presentation. And coming to the management side, especially the soft skills department, the pillars, the three team leaders, and the HOD, the Veda ma'am, the idea, because no ma'am, the idea, it will not come very easily, because the lot of collective ideas, it will become as a great idea. So as you have given that idea to us, and as the RSTs and the team leaders and the soft skills trainers, we all come together as a team, and we made it possible. I think we hope we reached your expectations. Thank you very much, ma'am, for creating such a platform to our students. It's really a very good platform. Ajay, you want to say something?
Thank you so much, Sadiq sir. Yes, I really appreciate the students for their performance today, both Prakasam and Hyderabad team. And I would like to thank all the trainers, soft skills department, Veda ma'am, Geeta ma'am. I know Geeta ma'am is always back of us, trying to find out if there is anything, you know, help required from the department. And that is very much thankful for Geeta ma'am and Veda ma'am. And also thankful for the principals. You know, even yesterday I was like in the practice session, though it was late night, the principals were still in the session and witnessing and trying to give encouragement to the students. That I really liked it. And I also thank everyone, not only from the Zoom session, but many others, they're watching out from YouTube and Facebook Live. You know, I thank everyone for making this program successful. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Ajay. One more person, like Shashank sir, for the technical support, because we have been continuously thanking you for your enormous support, because this is we need it, sir, because your support will give us a lot of a boost and to our students. So thank you once again to all the participants, to all the delegates, dignitaries, and everyone. So once again, thank you. You rock the show. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you.